Grand Prix had done in the park. They advised him, let's get it done. He certainly seems a lot happier since he's had it done. He tested the arm out, and when he crashed early on Thursday morning, he damaged his left shoulder rather than his right arm. But he really, again, looked in fine form. He's qualified fourth fastest. Of course, he was on the grid. He was on the podium in Barcelona 2 weeks ago. The first ever, the youngest rider on a MotoGP podium, and the first time he'd been on a MotoGP podium. But if you're talking about bravery, if you're talking about somebody special, you're talking about Shinya Nakano, aren't you?
Yeah, you could well be doing, because in Mugello, of course, he had that 200 mile an hour crash when his tire exploded. He rode superbly well to take Kawasaki's best ever finish at Catalunya just 7 days later. That was 2 weeks ago. He's gone one better this weekend. He's qualified fifth on the grid. Kawasaki's best ever MotoGP podium, and their best Grand Prix qualification since Cork Ballington. That's going back some time. That was at Imatra in Finland in 1981. He qualified fourth fastest on the 500, and after a spell out of Grand Prix, Kawasaki came back with a bit of a whimper last year, to be fair, but they certainly made big improvements this year, and Hoffman and Nakano look as though they're starting to get nearer and nearer to these front positions. And the fact that Nakano's qualified in front of so many Hondas as well, Nick, is a very big testament to the work that they've done.
I'm just actually down here with Shinya Nakano as you talk about Shinya there, Matthew. Shinya, here in fifth place on the grid, you keep getting better, he's qualifying, and can you keep this up in the race? That's the big question, isn't it?
This is a good question. Sure, I want to keep this position, but for us, not so easy, not to keep, with the race tire. But anyway, I will try my best.
Yeah, you got the best result so far for Kawasaki at the last race in Catalunya. The conditions are a lot better here, it's a lot cooler. We know there have been tyre problems, so do you think it could be even better here in Assen?
Yeah, I think so, because tyre working well here. So if I can follow the top guys, I think I have a chance.
There's a lot of people who want that to happen. Thanks very much for talking to us, and all the best.
Thanks very much.
Kenya Nakano sounds like he's just having an afternoon walk in the park, talking to Gavin, doesn't he? It's as calm as anything, but what a performance by him. Alongside him, as Matthew said, on the second row of the grid was Alex Barros, making his 200th Premier Class appearance. And then came on to the third row of the grid. Kenny Roberts on the Suzuki, as I say, had a good qualifying session. A little lucky, perhaps not to be a little bit higher up. And alongside him, Makoto Tomada is making his second appearance on the Camel Honda here at Assen, the second time he's ridden at the circuit, and he hasn't done too badly to qualify eight.
Matthew, just down here with Marco Melandri, and what a race it was from Marco in Catalunya, where we saw him get onto the podium. But that operation you've had on your arm since, Marco, how has it been feeling so far this weekend?
Yeah, for sure, we'll be so evil. I think every result would be like a bonus for me. Yeah, the arm during the practice was okay, but I did only this morning 5 laps consecutively with dry and start to feel a little bit less power.
Thanks so much, Marco. Good luck.
Marco Melandri just doing well to be out there, of course. He could have missed this race after having that operation last week. John Hopkins there qualifying well in 10th place. And again, proof, as I was about to mention before, that the Bridgestone qualifying tyres are very, very special indeed. Nakano in 5th, Robert 7th, Tomada 8th and Hopkins in 10th. And those guys all taking around a second and a half off the times that they were doing on race tyres just previous to that. Stick on the qualifier, in it goes. Alex Hoffman is another one using Bridgestone tyres. They seem to be working very, very well. They've got their qualifying tyre sorted out. They need to sort out a good race tyre, and perhaps we can see the likes of Kenny Roberts and John Hopkins challenging at the front, as well as, of course, Shinya Nakano, Makoto Tomada and Alex Hoffman. Now then, on to the outside of the fourth row, and an extremely disappointing performance from Max Biaggi. It's his birthday today, he's 33 years of age, and the chances of him looking as though he would celebrate that with a podium finish look slim.
He almost looks embarrassed there, didn't he? He almost looked pretty embarrassed so far down. They've had major problems within the team of getting the bike sorted out. They just don't seem to be able to do it at the moment. Well, we'll wait and see how he goes in the race. You've got the warm-up time there. How did he go in the warm-up? Not particularly good.
He was bad. 15th fastest.
Yeah, sorry, just as you see Neil Hodgson further down the grid, just an interesting thing about Hodgson. His fuel tank, the same on Ruben Schaus, it's covered in ice, as is the Ducati Desmond Sedici of Bayliss and Capi Rossi. But you can see it on the blue tank of Hodgson and Schaus. And it basically, they seem to have put that fuel tank in the freezer before going into this race. The ice has built up on the outside of that. Obviously, there's so much heat generated through those Ducatis, especially the 2000.
Well, Gav's been cut out there.
Too much heat.
Too much heat going through Gav's microphone. Hot air, as usual, coming out of Gav's eyes. But no, that interesting stuff there, the Ducatis. As Gav was rightly saying, so much heat going through them, especially the 2003 version of the bike. Capirossi and Bayliss now both on the 2004.
They also do that, though, of course, for fuel consumption. It does help with the fuel consumption. So I would imagine with the length of this race and the circuit, perhaps they're worried that the bikes won't run the full distance on the fuel as well. So it's a very interesting point. Sorry, on Dolores Capirossi.
Yeah, Capirossi 15th fastest, and again, as we were saying, they're using a new engine here this weekend, Ducati, a twin pulse engine, but not really had the desired effect. It's still got a lot of development in it, and again, similar to the 2004 bike itself, it's something that Capirossi and Bayliss feel has got plenty of development in it, but just not being able to get the results as early as they would like.
There is Troy Bayliss. A difficult time, Troy Bayliss. Very nasty accident in Barcelona the last couple of laps of the race. He was back on Monday, would you believe, testing the bike at the circuit despite that big bang. It was a remarkable achievement. He's had a bit of a rest now, and here he is back in action. It's been a tough time, as I said earlier, for Ducati, for their bounce back. Of that, there is no doubt at all. There is the front row of the grid. In the middle of that front row, Carlos Checa on the Yamaha. In pole position. Just getting himself mentally prepared. He seems so strong mentally. He laughs and jokes, Valentino Rossi. He's the most professional man prepared mentally and physically for this race.
Nineteen laps then of this, the longest circuit on the MotoGP calendar, just over 6 kilometres in length. The front row, Rossi, Checa, Gibernau. The second row, Melandri, Nakano, Barros.
Third row, Roberts, Tomada, Ruben Chaves. What a performance by the Spaniard. Row four, John Hopkins, Alex Hoffman, Max Biaggi.
Colin Edwards and Troy Bayliss, both former winners here. Capirossi, who was on the front row last year on pole position. Nicky Hayden, Norikabe and Shane Byrne on row six. McWilliams, Hodgson, Fabrizio on row seven. And Aoki, Curtis Roberts and Chris Burns on the final row of the grid. So the grid is finally dispersed, and there is Nobuasa Aoki and Curtis Roberts, the two protons, just going to start from pit lane there, so not making it onto the grid. And Gav, it'll be interesting to find out from the Proton team garage down there just exactly what's going on with those bikes, because there's certainly been no changes in the conditions. Valentino Rossi then starts from pole position. The green flag is out. We're ready for the warm-up lap here. As I say, 19 laps to go after this one. And I tell you what, Nick, the Yamahas of Carlos Checa and Valentino Rossi looking very, very strong indeed.
I just stormed off the line, didn't they? Sorry, Gavin, we pick you up once again. Over to Gavin in pit lane.
Yeah, I've arrived, I'm back.
Thank
the microphone actually
that.
Wasn't working on the grid, but anyway, I've just been speaking to the Proton Team KR, and they just said they had to bring them in, they had to get as much fuel into that bike as possible, really. That's the problem I was about to say with the Ducati, that they've got problems with fuel here, they've got problems as well, that not only does it evaporate and things like that, but it's just running the distance, just making sure the bike gets the distance. And it's going to be interesting next year when the fuel consumption goes down, but that's why Proton came into the pits, both the riders, just to fill it up to the brim on those Team KR machines.
There you are. Thank you, Cav. Good to have you back. And as we thought, fuel consumption, the worry of the teams. That's why some of them got ice on the tank. Because I think the cooler the conditions, the less the fuel evaporates in the tank. And consequently, they go through. But it'll be interesting to see towards the end of the race if anybody has a problem.
On board with Marco Melandri. And you can see why he would have wanted that arm pump operation. Having to work so hard on top of that Yamaha, and especially around this circuit, it really, really works the riders here. It's a rider's circuit. That's the Destrubben corner there. You can see that tight left-hander. We'll talk about that a few times in this race, I can tell you. And then just after it, this fast, sweeping section of S's on board with Alex Barros, putting a handful of front brake.
He's had quite a weekend. He's had a party to celebrate his 200th Premier Class Grand Prix. He fell off in the morning practice on Friday, and he fell off in qualifying on Friday in the wet and the dry, almost bringing down his teammate Nicky Hayden. In fact, when he went down yesterday afternoon, he was perfectly okay, but sort of summed up his career in Grand Prix racing. It's rough and tough at that level, and he's had a tough time, but a great competitor, Alex Barros. You'd feel now he really wants to start making progress on that Repsol Honda. He's obviously replaced Valentino Rossi in the team, and he really is looking for some sort of result. But I think, as Matthew said, the Yamahas really are on song here, and the only Honda you really feel that would challenge them is that Honda of Sete Gibernau. I'd have said before we arrived here that Max Biaggi might have also been able to challenge them. He's won a 500cc race here, he's won 250cc races here, but he's had his problems during qualifying. I think he's too far down the grid, what he's qualified 13th fastest, to do it. So can anybody stop the doctor? Can anybody stop Valentino Rossi making it three successive Grand Prix victories? The grid lines up. This is going to be 19 laps. The Cathedral Grand Prix motorcycle racing. We're at Assen, 6.027 kilometres, 3.745 miles. One of the most famous strip of tarmac in Grand Prix motorcycle racing. They started here in 1925. They've been Grand Prix racing here since 1949.
Seems to be a bit of a problem, a bit of confusion there between Aoki and Curtis Roberts. Both riders having to start from the back of the grid after joining the warm-up lap from pit lane after refilling their fuel tanks. As Gav told us, from pit lane, there is Nobuatsu Aoki being pushed back by the marshal to the back row of the grid. As I say, Curtis Roberts there and Nobuatsu Aoki just topping up their fuel tanks before the start of this race.
Right, the red flag has been taken away. Round six of the MotoGP World Championships. Can Rossi make it three in a row? The lights are out. Good start by Carlos Checa right down the middle.
Watch out for Shinya Nakano as well, getting a decent start from the second row, but there's no doubt about it. It's Carlos Checa who leads the way. Rossi just through the left kink and into the right-hander, just getting slightly inside, but Gibernau gets tight as well into third place.
Looks like also a fair old start from Alex Barros, I think, in fourth place. Checa leads the way. Gibernau on the charge. Is that Gibernau that's taken the lead? He's come between him and Rossi, and he's got past Checa at the front. So Checa's second, Rossi third. Looks like Alex Barros in fourth place. But Gibernau means business.
Yeah, good start for once from Alex Barros. Good start as well from Max Biaggi here. He comes up on the inside of Melandri into fifth place. So Max Biaggi, who had a dreadful time in qualifying, started from 12th on the grid. He's made an excellent start to this race.
Just the start we wanted. The Hondas are up there to challenge the Yamahas. Sete Gibernau, the championship leader, leads the way. He's had to concede defeat at the last two Grand Prix to his bitter rival, his great rival, Valentino Rossi. But now the gloves are off around the most famous circuit in Grand Prix motorcycle racing. Gibernau leads Rossi with Checa in third place, Alex Barros and Max Biaggi.
Melandri sits, Shaw seventh, Hopkins doing well in eighth from Capirossi, Nakano, Bayliss and Edwards, both former winners here in their World Superbikes days, not doing very well at all. And Nicky Hayden, who started from 16th on the grid, he's way down there, still in 16th position, really struggling to get to grips with this circuit.
Half a lap gone, they're down at Mandeven. Round the right-hander, second gear, bright sunshine, massive crowd as always. Last Saturday in June, Dutch TT. They're going to be pouring out of this circuit as soon as this race is over to watch the football. Holland still in Euro 2004. But at first, they're going to be excited. They're going to be entertained by the MotoGP stars. Gibernau leads Rossi. How many times have we said that this season? Carlos Checa still in third place. Alex Barros right in there with them in fourth.
And it's Max Biaggi, Melandri, Schaus, Hopkins, Capirossi and Nakano all in there. They cross the line for the first time, lap one of 19. And it's Sete Gibernau, last year's winner, who currently holds off Valentino Rossi at the front. Here comes Colin Edwards up on the inside of Shinya Nakano. That's for 10th place. Colin Edwards starting to make some progress. Behind him is Troy Bayliss in 12th, Kenny Roberts 13th. Nicky Hayden starting to make up some ground there in 14th as well. Neil Hodgson having a tough time. He won the second Superbike race here after finishing second in the first race and clinching the title. And really, this is an example of what a step up in quality it is from World Superbikes to MotoGP. Hodgson currently down in 19th spot.
Awesome, Brocken, they're through there. They're now at the Struben, around that bank left-hander. This is, I think, the most exciting part of the Assen circuit. down behind the pit. The Veenslang, flat out, sixth gear, 175 miles an hour through the kink. Gibernau leads Rossi. Checker hanging in there. Barros in fourth place. Down to Steckenval, the left, and now the right. Let's look further down the field because we just get Checker, we just get Barros. And behind them, Biaggi. Biaggi made a remarkable start, didn't he? I think we were saying what a bad time he had. But Biaggi still leads the way from Melandri. Chow 7th, Hopkins 8th, 9th Caparossi, Nakano in 10th place, Colin Edwards 11th. I think Edwards, in fact, has now got in front of Shinya Nakano.
Yeah, you know, Nick, it was always going to be a question for Alex Barros and Max Biaggi. Probably the only two men outside the top three who had a realistic chance of following Gibernau, Biaggi and Checker. They had to get a good start from the line. They did just that. Barros is right in there. Biaggi just not quite in touch at the moment, but there or thereabouts. And here comes Barros on the brakes up on the inside of Carlos Checker. And Barros up to third place. Well, it's been a topsy-turvy weekend so far for the Brazilian. Three crashes in qualifying. But he's turning it on in the race, the 2,500cc winner here at Assen. And he's pulling it together. Remember, we only had one dry session all weekend here. It's been very, very tough for the guys to get the bike set up. Certainly, Rossi and Checker and Melandri all demonstrating that the Yamaha have really met their objectives for the start of the season to get that bike fast out of the box. There goes Melandri back on the inside of Biaggi, in fact. And Biaggi back around the outside of Melandri. Those two Italians really having a good old scrap there. But certainly it seems that the Yamaha, as I said, it's been quick out of the box so far. It's just what Jeremy Burgess and Valentino Rossi wanted to do with it. It's benefited the likes of Marco Melandri and Carlos Checa. And in a situation like this weekend, it was perfect because they only had one session to sort out the setup of these machines, the gearbox settings, the suspension and chassis and all the rest of it. And the Honda guys, who've really struggled, and Max Biaggi running off track there as well, just briefly. Max Biaggi, one of them in particular, who relies on such a critical setup for his Honda. They've had so many problems sorting out that new chassis that they got just before the Urta test pre-season, which were all hit by bad weather. It's really affected them this season. And a case in point was this weekend. Now, this is Biaggi again, just running it wide. This is where Rossi had problems this morning. Rossi did virtually exactly the same thing as Biaggi there, running just off track onto the grass, but pulling back on just in time.
Look at Ruben Chout. He is absolutely flying. He's in seventh place. He's right in there with the battle of the former two 250cc world champions, both former winners here at Assen. Ruben Chout right on the rear wheel there of the Yamaha over Marco Melandri. He's riding the Dantin Ducati, last year's machine. He really has impressed everybody, the former world superbike runner-up, Ruben Chout, this year. He's put in some masterful performances. And there he is, right behind Melandri and Biaggi. What a Ruben Chaus, who's brought great entertainment to us already this season.
It looks like Biaggi's really, really struggling just to keep in front of Marco Melandri there, really riding the wheels off that Honda at the moment. Assen not the easiest place to pass, so it's going to be interesting to see whether Melandri can make one of those passes that he keeps trying on Biaggi, whether he can make him stick.
Yeah, well, this circuit really suiting the Yamaha. It's all about agility and stability here at Assen through these fast sections. And again, as I was saying before, that's something that Yamaha have always had in abundance, and they've really worked hard on this year. It's such an agile bike. Rossi said that. He was asked to describe the Yamaha in one word coming into this race, and he said agile, and that's perfect for this circuit. And Marco Melandri now will try and use that to his advantage as he works his way around Max Biaggi.
At the front, it's still Gibernau that leads the way. This is the battle between the former 250cc world champions, two Italians, Max Biaggi and Marco Melandri. Gibernau still holds off Rossi. Barros still fighting a battle with Carlos Checker.
Loris Caparossi there behind them is leading the second group, and Colin Edwards and John Hopkins are right in it because Colin Edwards has actually just got past John Hopkins for ninth place coming down the straight. So Edwards ninth, Hopkins 10th, and behind them, Nicky Hayden has also made further ground. He's up to 11th. He's got past Shinya Nakano.
Gibernau leads. Rossi second, right behind him. I think that's a perfect illustration of just how nimble and agile that Yamaha is. Bottom end of the circuit once again. Bright sunshine. Mandeven, and they start coming back towards the start and finish their halfway through the lap. There's 15 and a half laps to go. This looks like a typical Rossi performance so far. He's just stalking Sete Gibernau, just sorting out what's what and where's where. Gibernau having to do all the hard work at the front at the moment. Alex Barros still in third place. And we just get a glimpse there of Carlos Checa, and then the battle of those former 250cc world champions. We ride with the world champion Valentino Rossi through the chicane, over the start and finish line. 15 laps to go. Rossi second, Gibernau still leads the way.
Alex Barros with the fastest lap of the race, 2:01.78. And that is a new lap record here at Assen. It smashes the previous record by 0.8 seconds that was held by Valentino Rossi, and it's a massive step forward for Alex Barros. Here we're watching that fight again, as Gav was saying, Max Biaggi trying so hard to hold off Marco Melandri. Melandri had that arm pump operation in Barcelona last week, and he's looking for a way around Max Biaggi once again. Really, the early stages of this race will be the key for Melandri, because we know that in the second half, he's got to start to struggle with the strength in that right arm. Just over a week after it being operated on, it's another brave ride from the young Italian, who scored his first MotoGP podium 2 weeks ago at Catalunya. And look at Alex Barros, Nick. As I said, there is the confirmation of that fastest lap, 2:01.78. He's closing down on Gibernau and Rossi. And you have to say, as I was saying before, it rained here on Thursday, it rained again on Friday. It only dried up on Friday afternoon. That was the only session these guys had to set the bikes up. And it was right at the start of the session that Alex Barros crashed. So he had to ride his second bike during qualifying. I honestly thought that Barros would not have the setup here, but it seems that perhaps all those years of experience and that technical backup he's got at Repsol Honda have known just to squeeze everything they could out of the morning warm-up this morning and really sort out a setup for the race.
It seems to me as well, Alex Barros is such an Assen specialist as well, isn't he? Races like in 2000 when he won it on that Honda Pons, and when he was fighting as well with Valentino Rossi a couple of years ago with the 500 against the V5 four-stroke with Rossi as well. Fantastic races from Barros, such a specialist here in Assen, and with it being such a rider circuit, I really think it suits him down to the ground.
Yeah, in fact, Gav, Alex Barros has got 5 podiums here on 3 different types of machinery, and he won here on the two-stroke Honda in 2000. So really, he's got bags of experience up his sleeves, Alex Barros. Very, very adaptable, as you say, to this circuit. It is a rider's circuit, and it's certainly Alex Barros' circuit. He's starting to put pressure now on Valentino Rossi in second place, who in turn is just squeezing Sete Gibernau a bit at the front as well. We see them cross the line. That circuit record of Alex Barros has been broken once again, first by Valentino Rossi, then by Alex Barros, right behind him once again, almost 2 minutes dead. Could we see the 2 minute mark broken for the first time? And there's a crash in the middle of that. Michel Fabrizio, the Italian, on the WCM machine. Well, Fabrizio's back on his feet, but the bike, it seems as though they're having trouble to actually move it there. Both wheels are jammed, you can see why. It looks as though that might have been a high side there for Fabrizio. Hopefully the marshals can get the track clear, because the battle at the front is shaping up very nicely indeed.
Yeah, Fabrizio had a magnificent ride during the first qualifying session in the rain, brought WCM some real heart. But that's a nasty looking accident. I'm happy to see him walk away. Let's just run through the field for you, because Biaggi in fifth place, Melandri, Klaus, Caparossi 8, 9 Edwards, 10 Hayden, 11 Hopkins, 12 Nakano, 13 Troy Bayliss, 14 Tamada, and 15th Norik Abe, completing the point scoring. But at the front, Gibernau fighting off the combined challenge of Valentino Rossi and Alex Barros. Little bit of a gap, not so big. And Carlos Checa, slightly bigger gap. Melandri, Biaggi, and Ruben Chaus. What a ride by him once again.
Curtis Roberts just coming into the pits there, so despite having gone in to fill the bike full of fuel, they're not going to make it to the end of this race, the Proton Team KR. Not with Curtis Roberts anyway, he's retired out of the race, and that crash from Fabrizio, that was horrific. It looked like a seizure or something like that, the way the bike wouldn't roll as well afterwards. Just wonder what that was. Let's hope Fabrizio is okay.
Well, Fabrizio, we saw on our screens, Gav, don't know what you saw down there from pit lane, but he was back on his feet, so it looks as though Fabrizio is okay. And fortunately for us, the race continues at the front. No red flag necessary. On board with Alex Barros at the end of the straight. Look at the stability of the Yamaha, of Valentino Rossi on the brakes. It barely moves at all, coming down from what, almost 300 miles an hour down to that second gear right-hander, around 55 miles an hour through there. And the Yamaha barely moved, did it? You could see absolutely so stable, so agile, and working very well around this Assen circuit. But Rossi now really fighting a lone battle against the two Hondas. Checa just dropping off the back a little bit, conceding a couple of tenths really with each lap, and it's crucial tenths at at this stage of the race that could see the difference between him battling with these guys for the podium or drifting away and just settling for fourth place.
12 and a half laps to go. Gibernau still holds the advantage. Rossi second. Barros really looking threatening in third place. Just got a glimpse there of Carlos Checa. Marco Melandri just opened up a little bit of a gap over Max Biaggi in their battle for fifth place.
Big race this for Alex Barros, Nick. Of course, a very disappointing start to the season. And the look on the Honda boss's faces in the garage when he crashed at the start of qualifying yesterday said it all. As it did, you know, last or 2 weeks ago at Catalunya, Nicky Hayden also having a terrible time of it there as well. And the pressure is on Alex Barros.
Yeah, it certainly is, but he's got the experience to soak up that sort of pressure. But yeah, I mean, he was well placed. If you think 2 weeks ago in Barcelona, he was absolutely flying in that race until he crashed out of the race. He may have been in the challenge, these two men at the front, but we never found out. But yes, this is a big race for Alex Barros. He loves the circuit like all the other riders. He has won here previously. And he's got to stay with these two leading men. At the moment, he seems capable of doing that. Lap times, just over 2 minutes and a half seconds. So the pace pretty quick, but their lap records, you get the feeling they could go quicker when they really have to.
Yeah, we've seen that. They've gone around half a second quicker than they are doing at the moment. Max Biaggi, actually the fastest man on the circuit at the moment there, a sixth fastest. The first man ever to break the two-minute mark here at Assen. So watch out for Biaggi. He seems to have found something there after a few laps. Those tyres maybe just scrubbing in and suiting Biaggi. He's down in sixth place at the moment. But as I say, he's just done a 159.983, 2/10 quicker than Barros' previous lap record here, which was set earlier in the race. Watch out for Biaggi now in sixth place. He's got the two Yamahas of Checa and Melandri in front of him, but for how long?
Yeah, Melandri certainly is close right up on the rear wheel there of Carlos Checa. There they are. There is Max Biaggi. Ruben Chaus just hanging in there, still in seventh place. That 2003 Ducati. Gibernau, Rossi, Barros. Then a tremendous battle between Checa, Melandri and Biaggi. This is the battle for the lead. Then you've just got the two red Yamahas and the yellow Honda, then Chaus. Behind Chaus, brief glimpse of Loris Caparossi, of course, who set the pole time here last year on the Ducati.
Nicky Hayden making good progress as well there, Nick. He's got past Hopkins, Bayliss, Edwards. Nicky Hayden now up to ninth, so saving his best for the race. He's just over 5.5 seconds off the leader, Sete Gibernau. Oh, and there's the second Proton rider, Nobuatsu Aoki. What disappointment for them. Aoki and Curtis Roberts both out of the race. But as I say, Nicky Hayden now starting to put something together. His lap times are actually the same pace as the leaders as well, Nicky Hayden. So just over 5 seconds down. But if he could have just got a better grid position, if he could have just got a better start, who knows? Nicky Hayden could have been at the front here, and that would have been a massive achievement at a circuit like this. Nicky's really struggled this weekend. It's such a technical circuit, real fast and flowing, and it really suits a smooth and accurate riding style, and that's not Nicky's way of riding. All that dirt track experience, it's really he likes to get that bike stopped in the middle of the corner, turned and squirted out again. It's not suited him here at all, but he certainly seems to be learning at every round, and that's the way forward for Nicky Hayden. He's learning in the race now, and as I say, he's putting together a pace that would bring him up here with these leading riders. There is Nicky Hayden now, just behind Loris Caparossi. He's got past Colin Edwards, as I said before. He's in ninth place. But the pace has been picked up again at the front. Nicky Hayden here is going to start putting pressure on Loris Caparossi for eighth place. And disappointed, as I know that he would be with eighth place, Nicky Hayden. It really would be a sign of the progress he's made over the course of the weekend. As I say, a very, very difficult circuit. All the men in front of him, barring Ruben Jaus, are men with years and years of Grand Prix experience, and that is so crucial at this circuit.
Really closed up at the front with 10 and a half laps ago. Gibernau still leads the way, but Rossi's close. Barros certainly is close indeed, and we've seen Rossi now set the fastest lap, the first man under 2 minutes, 159.957 for the world champion. As Matthew predicted, the pace is now beginning to really hot up. Went in just a little bit wide there, Rossi, but then closes right on the rear wheel of Sete Gibernau. Arrived with the champion. In his view, the championship leader. This hopefully is going to go all the way to the checkered flag. We switch cameras almost automatically. We now arrive with Gibernau and we look at Rossi. Brilliant onboard stuff. Who's going to have nobody in front of him? Who's going to have a blank space in front of him? And they cross the start and finish line in what? 10 and a half laps time. Rossi chasing his third consecutive victory. Gibernau trying to open up that five-point lead in the championship. If Rossi beats him, he wins the race, and Gibernau finishes second. They'll be equal on points, but Rossi will actually lead the championship because he's won more Grand Prix this season. It's that tight as they go through the chicane, and this is where it can all happen on the very, very last lap. Over the start and finish line, 10 laps here to go at Assen.
Few different lines through that chicane, as you can see now. Barros drafting Rossi at the end of the straight. Who's going to be the latest on the brakes? It's a brave man to challenge Alex Barros in that sort of situation. Rossi is brave enough, but on this occasion he's just not quite late enough to break with the Brazilian. Now can Alex Barros challenge Sete Gibernau for the lead here with 10 laps to go? It's Barros in second place, Rossi in third, then a slight gap. It's Melandri in fourth, and Max Biaggi's got past Carlos Checa for fifth.
It's almost that Rossi was caught by surprise there, wasn't it? I think perhaps he was concentrating on Sete Gibernau, and suddenly we ride with Alex Barros, who went round the outside and pulled back across the track. I wouldn't say you'd have fancied Rossi to get up the inside of him, because Barros is the demon of the late breakers. And Barros now up into second place. Rossi relegated to third. Gibernau still leads the way. 9.5 laps to go. And Honda's fight back against the might of Yamaha.
You got a glimpse from that onboard footage, just what this circuit's all about, especially with the rev counter, just hanging around mid-revs, really, mid to high revs, and it just makes us realise why we thought Yamaha would go so well, because it's not all about top-end power, which they know they're down on. Rossi says they need 10 horsepower more to be up there with the Hondas. He reckons the Honda's still the best bike, but around here, it's all about that mid-range power, and the riders feel that they're all pretty equal in that area, and it's the riders that can make the difference. That's why they love this track so much. The riders have to read the camber and all the corners that they have. They have to read whether it's positive and it just goes over negative because it's crowned in the middle. They love this track. And you just got, from that onboard footage, you could just see why they love the track so much and why they feel that the riders make the difference in Assen.
Well, the man making the difference at the moment is Alex Barros, as we said, up to second place and on a real charge. Valentino Rossi not too happy and just getting around the outside of the Brazilian, then up the inside, and back up to second place. And again, just a demonstration of the agility of that Yamaha. Now we're going to see another demonstration of the power of the Honda down the straight. Well, Gav, as you said, it's mainly mid-throttle here at Assen, but just that straight there is just enough for Alex Barros to really stretch the legs, and now he's going to stretch the wheels as well, because Alex Barros has flipped out of this race at the end of the straight. He left it too late on the brakes, and another disaster in a disastrous season for the Brazilian.
Dear, oh dear, oh dear for Alex Barros. Hard on corner. I hope he hasn't hurt himself. He rolls over and he loses the rear end to start with, and then it flicks him off. Nasty looking accident. His 200th appearance in the Premier Class of Grand Prix Racing ends in disaster for Alex Barros as he was challenging for the lead.
On board here with Valentino Rossi there. You can see it, the black line at the back of Barros's Honda just left on the track. There is rear wheel locking up. Don't know whether that was some sort of mechanical problem or whether Barros just left it too late on the brakes. He had to really stamp on it at the end and it just spat him off. Now it's a two-man battle at the front between Gibernau, who's led for virtually this whole race, for Valentino Rossi. Now just a bit of a gap to him in second place, but he's quickly closed that up. Now we've got Marco Melandri in third place, Max Biaggi in fourth place, and Carlos Checa in fifth.
Right, Gibernau's done all the donkey work at the front, hasn't he? He's had to do all the hard work at the front. Rossi, I would say, he's been content to stay in second place, and I think Barros caught him a little bit by surprise when he relegated him to third. But now, let battle commence. 8.5 laps to go. Has Gibernau got the pace to hold off Rossi? Well, we're not going to probably find out just yet, because I think there'll be a little bit more sparring before we find out as the race unfolds. We ride with Sete Gibernau right behind him, Valentino Rossi. 5 points separate them in the championship as they go through the chicane and across the line. That would be 8 laps to go. And what a beautiful overtaking maneuver the lap before by Rossi on Barros. He absolutely set the Brazilian up perfectly before he took him at the chicane. That's where he might try to take Gibernau, but has he got the power to the line to hang in there?
Well, he may not have the power to the line, but he's got the pace through the rest of the circuit, Nick. And as we've seen now, another fastest lap, 159.870 for Valentino Rossi. Just gradually dropping the circuit record here. Of course, the old circuit record belonging to Kevin Schwantz, that was never beaten until the track was changed in 2002. This slightly changed circuit now. The record belongs to Valentino Rossi, and will victory here belong to him as well? He's really closed up on the back wheel of Sete Gibernau, and he knows that if he can beat him here, he will lead the World Championship going to Rio in a week's time, where of course he won the World Championship 2 years ago. He likes a party in Rio, Valentino Rossi. And
I think he's won the last four races in Rio, hasn't he? 500cc and MotoGP, so he's got a very good record there. He's got a certain battle this afternoon to get out of his way before he gets on the plane to Rio, though, and Sete Gibernau will not make it easy for him. But you've got to say, Rossi looks very, very comfortable in second place. That's Marco Melandri up into third place, I think, is it, in front of Carlos Checo?
I was just about to say that, Nick. Yeah, he's cut the gap by half a second during this lap to the front two. So Melandri, we thought he was going to get weaker as the race went on, just seems to be getting stronger and stronger.
Hey, Barcelona doctors, they've obviously done a very good job. Can Marco Melandri join in the front? There we are, that's the gap. Perfect timing, 1.288 seconds, it's down, he's cut another tenth off. And Marco Melandri is absolutely flying in second place. When he won the 125cc race here, he's the youngest ever rider to win a Grand Prix. He's also won the 250cc race here. He loves Assen, and he certainly seems to be...
He's run wide. Marco Melandri coming into the chicane, into the start-finish straight, runs it wide. He was pushing so, so hard there to cut down the gap to Gibernau and Rossi. He's hung on to third place, but he's lost that crucial time that he was making up. Oh, that's so disappointing for Marco Melandri. He was riding so, so well. Further down there, you can see Nicky Hayden's really made some ground up as well. They've got past there. Boris Capirossi, Hayden and Edwards both passed him. Let's have another look at this. He just got into the chicane a bit too hot, didn't he? Melandri just managed to hang on to it, though, across the gravel. And here, as we ride with the young Italian, we'll see him shake his head slightly as he looked behind him. And, well, he knows that he was catching Rossi and Gibbon out the front there. But I tell you what, he's riding with... certainly not 100% here, with heavy stitching in his arm. We could see Marco Melandri by the end of the season, if he keeps progressing with that Yamaha, challenging Valentino Rossi and Sete Gibernau for a race victory. It looks like it. He's in third place at the moment. He's got Max Biaggi for company now in fourth. Then it's Checa, then it's Schaus. But Schaus is starting to come under pressure now from Nicky Hayden. Loris Capirossi just behind them as well. But you have to say, Nick, apart from the obvious choices, Rossi and Gibbon out the front, the two impressive men in the 2004 season so far have been Marco Melandri and Ruben Schaus.
Couldn't agree with you more. Very, very impressive indeed. Melandri now is going to have the battle very hard to hold off Biaggi. And you saw him shake his head and then look behind him as he came through the chicane. The horrible thing about if you run onto the chicane is when you come back onto the track in the second part, you might take somebody out. And Biaggi was just far enough behind him not to have a problem. But Biaggi now, I'm sure, will ride very hard indeed at the front. It's still Rossi hounding. He's like an annoying child, isn't he? You can't get rid of him. He's like one of those dogs that follow you around. He's just going to hang in there. He hopes he can force Sete Gibernau to make a mistake. I don't know if he can do that. He certainly did that a few times to Max Biaggi. He's going to pressure him. There's six laps to go when they cross the line. I think you're going to start seeing him now just stick the front wheel alongside Sete Gibernau's rear wheel a couple of times. If he can get that close, just keep exerting the pressure. And then, of course, he's going to make his move in the next six laps. As Matthew said, if he won the race, Rossi from Gibernau, he would lead the World Championship. This is the battle for third place. That's between Biaggi and Melandri. Melandri just hanging on the third place. And there's our man, Ruben Schaus, battling hard with Nicky Hayden right behind him.
Nicky Hayden, I tell you what, he's got the podium in his sights now. He's up to seventh place, but it's a close bunch, that Melandri, Biaggi, Checa, of course, as well in there, and Schaus and Hayden, they're all together, and with 5.5 laps to go, or well, more than that, 6 laps to go really for those guys behind this, the lead two. Nicky Hayden has got a chance of fighting his way through and turning at what really promised to be a very, very disappointing weekend after qualifying, what, 16th fastest, into perhaps one of his greatest weekends in Grand Prix so far.
I'm down on pit wall at the moment with Mick Doohan. That was an unlucky crash for Alex Barros, really just pushing it too far into the corner.
It's difficult to know exactly what happened, whether there was a small malfunction with the bike or whether he touched the rear brake or whatever, because it was an unusual crash with the back end to let go like that. So until we speak to him, until we see what the bike data says, it's really a hard one to speculate on the blame either party.
Gibernau and Rossi, Honda Yamaha at the front. It's going to be right down to the wire, this one.
Well, it looks to be. I'm hoping for Honda. Sete's sake, that Sete can hold good. You know, it'd be good to have three each. But again, Rossi's hanging in there, and it looks like he's doing it quite comfortably, especially in the last half of the track. And that's really the last part that counts, isn't it? So.
Even Nicky Hayden now, he's up to sixth place. He's in a good race, actually, to come through. It's just the start that's let him down there.
Well, he's really only second and a half, or less than that, of third place. So anything can happen. We've got six laps to go. With Melandri running off, it's only helping him. Right. He's come through. Hopefully, he might end up on the podium.
OK, thanks very much for talking to us, Nicky. Let's see what happens then.
Well, we're going to keep our eyes fixed on Nicky Hayden, but at the moment, we've got to watch these two men at the front. They've been battling out throughout the five rounds so far this season. Sete Gibernau, Valentino Rossi, but I just got a hint in Mick Doohan's voice, didn't you? He didn't want to say that Yamaha looked strong. He wanted to say, Sete Gibernau, we're going to win this race, but he just said Valentino Rossi looks very comfortable in second place. He's hounding him, isn't he? He's just pressuring him all the time.
Mick definitely didn't want to say that. Honda Bigwig stood next to him as I was driving.
Yeah.
I spoke to him after the last race, and he does say that Honda just need to pull their finger out. He says they've got to be up there. Sete seems to be doing a lot of the work at the moment, and Honda need to bring something else out of the bag to challenge Rossi and Yamaha.
Yeah, it's, I'm sure it's a case of split loyalties, really, for Mick. I'm not doubting his professionalism for one second. Of course, he is a Honda man. He works for Honda as well, of course. But he can't help but have a soft spot for Valentino Rossi, who he really sees as the only man out there worthy. And Valentino Rossi now up the inside of Sete Gibernau. But no doubt, Mick Doohan has said it many, many times while Rossi was a Honda rider, and still now as a Yamaha rider, that he's a class above the rest here. He does have a soft spot for him. Of course, all his old mechanics, Jerry Burgess and the rest, are working for Rossi now. Now then, here comes Nicky Hayden, Honda's latest prodigy. He's up to fifth place. He's been working hard with Mick Doohan all weekend to find out the secrets to this track, and it looks as though he's worked them out. This is a superb ride from Nicky Hayden from 16th on the grid. He's fought his way through the field. He's got past Ruben Schaus now, as I say. He's up to fifth position. He's got Max Biaggi and Marco Melandri in his sights, and he's got 4.5 laps to catch them.
There is Ruben Schaus and Colin Evans just behind him. Colin Checker dropping back through the field. Oh! Colin Edwards, magnificent overtaking manoeuvre by the American, former World Superbike champion. He absolutely caught Toast by surprise. But at the front, with four laps to go, Rossi, as we said, just put the front wheel alongside Sete Gibernau a couple of times. He's just turning the screws a little bit now, just exerting more and more pressure. Gibernau will soak up that pressure, but for how long? There is Hayden. Behind Hayden, Colin Edwards, Ruben Schaus, Carlos Checker and Loris Caparossi. But Hayden's got a lot of work to do in four laps to catch Marco Melandri and Max Biaggi.
Yeah, but look at the gap, Nick, that he's already put between himself, Edwards, Schaus, Checker and Caparossi. He's streaking away from that group now. We'll keep an eye on the lap times as they come round. Gibernau and Rossi go through with four laps to go. Their lap times at 2 minutes, 0.190. Well, that was for Sete Gibernau on the previous lap. But we will certainly keep an eye on Nicky Hayden's progress. He's up to fifth place, as we said before. He's charged through from 16th on the grid. He's got ahead of Colin Edwards, and then Ruben Schaus behind him, Carlos Checker and Loris Caparossi. This still the battle at the front between Gibernau and Rossi. This is something we've become accustomed to seeing over the past couple of seasons. And Gibernau, the world championship leader, a 5-point advantage over Rossi in the standings. Two wins for Gibernau this season, three for Rossi. Will it be three all after this weekend? Will Gibernau be able to stretch out that advantage to 10 points, or will Rossi be able to reel him in and level the scores after six rounds?
You can just see from that footage there, it just came through that left-right, just see how nimble that Yamaha is and how light it looks, how easy it looks for Rossi to just flick it left and then flick it right through there, and just seems to make up the room on Gibernau.
Yeah,
he's exerting the pressure all the time now, isn't he? That's exactly what he's doing, what, with 3.25 laps to go.
Yeah, I think especially through that last chicane as well, it's so important there. We're going to see it now. Look at the line that Rossi takes, especially, not this one, but this corner here. He just cuts onto the rumble strip there. They've got new paving stones down. We've seen him do it a couple of times, not so much on that lap, as we see Sete Gibernau set the fastest lap of the race, But on the previous laps, Rossi, he really cuts across that corner, and that could be the key. As we see with three laps to go, they just couldn't be closer together. Gibernau with the fastest lap of the race, a 59.782. Rossi with his fastest lap of the race, a 159.824. Keep an eye on Nicky Hayden. He's done a 2.549, so not really fast enough to close any ground down on Biaggi and Melandri. There are Melandri and Biaggi. Melandri in third place, chasing his second podium in successive weekends. Max Biaggi tight behind him in fourth place. Nicky Hayden not quite able to shake off the attentions of his fellow American Colin Edwards, who set his fastest lap of the race so far with a 2:02.96. And you have to say it, that the Hondas really have found something surely this morning, particularly Edwards, Hayden, Biaggi. They look to be struggling so much in qualifying, particularly yesterday afternoon, to find some sort of setup. But this morning in the race, they've really pulled it together.
Again, perfect illustration, wasn't it? On top speed, the Honda was so quick there, but through the little lefts and rights, the fast left and rights, Rossi was able to close on the Yamaha. Gibernau, though, full marks to Sete. Gibernau, he's put in a magnificent performance at the front. Fastest lap of the race. He's desperate to hang on to this World Championship lead. 2.5 laps to go. And Rossi's going to have to work very, very hard to get past him, but I think he probably will. But Gibernau has responded in the best possible way for that fastest lap of the race. 2.5 to go. Just opens up a bit of an advantage, Gibernau, doesn't he? But it's on this part of the circuit when they come back towards the start and finish up towards the chicane that Rossi really closes up. He sizes him up for the chicane. I don't know if he dare leave it that late to actually try and win the race. But they're coming up to the chicane now. And this is where you feel that Rossi will make his move. If he makes it before, then perhaps he will have problems. Two laps to go. It's a giant high-speed game of chess. Who's going to come out the king?
Well, this is the fight still for third place. It's a Honda and a Yamaha fighting out at the front for first and second. It's a Honda and a Yamaha fighting out for third and fourth at the moment. It's the Yamaha of Marco Melandri on top from his much more experienced team or compatriot, Max Biaggi, in fourth place. Nicky Hayden taking a second off both of those riders on that last lap. So Nicky Hayden now just a second behind them. So Hayden really closing the gap with two laps to go. Hayden could be in that battle for third place. The lap times really dropped off of Melandri and Biaggi. They're not sure if they came together or something happened between them, but they both dropped a second off their lap times, as I said, and Nicky Hayden was able to use that to his advantage and really close them down. A battle between Melandri and Biaggi could just help Hayden catch them.
Back at the front, 1.5 laps to go. Fastest part of the circuit, through the fiend slang, sixth gear, 175, 180 miles an hour, and still Gibernau holds the advantage, and you'd say, just from this helicopter shot, perhaps it's a bit bigger than it was on the previous lap. He is putting in a sterling effort. Biaggi's gone past Melandri to take third place. So Biaggi takes third place, but Melandri just gets back in front of him as Biaggi runs it wide. And Biaggi is back in third place. Unbelievable. Oh, they're back again. Who is going to be in third place? It's going to be Marco Melandri. And while this happens, it's just opening the way for Nicky Hayden to close on him. You can see Nicky Hayden, he's brought Colin Edwards along as well.
Yeah, Marco Melandri running it wide again. That replay was from the previous lap where we saw Nicky Hayden take a big chunk out of these two, and Hayden, and as you say, Nick, has brought Edwards with him. The two Americans fighting now for a podium position with just over, 1.5 laps to go. You could see them get back into it.
Something's happening at the front. I think Sete Gibernau is really opened it out a little bit over Rossi. Rossi closes on the brakes. There we are. We're looking at the battle for third place. And here we go. We're on the last lap. Is Gibernau going to win this race? Oh, Marco Melandri's gone back in front of Max Biaggi. Look at Nicky Hayden right behind them. And Colin Edwards. One lap to go for the final podium position. And Nicky Hayden is right in there with a chance.
Max Biaggi at the end of the straight with the extra horsepower of the Honda, but Rossi's closed right up on Gibernau. He set the fastest lap of the race on the previous lap, a 159.472 for Rossi. His problem is that it was only 1,000th of a second quicker than Sete Gibernau, but on this last lap already, he's closed up on the Spaniard. This is going to go down to the final chicane. We've seen how many different lines you can get through that chicane. Who out of these two riders is going to be able to pick the best one? Because believe me, it's going all the way. Here comes Rossi. He might try and make a move on Sete Gibernau before then. They go through that banked, disturbing corner, and they could not be closer together. The battle rages behind them between Biaggi, Hayden, Melandri and Edwards for that final podium position.
Rossi is very, very close indeed with half a lap to go. Rossi, without a doubt, is going to make a move at any move time now. They're at Steckenwald. Still Rossi. Here comes Rossi now. He's on the outside. Gibernau, very, very well ridden at the front. No way through at the moment. Left and right. They're on the right-hander. Rossi could not be closer. Rossi's going to make his move up the inside. Rossi leads the race for the first time. Gibernau tries to fight back. Half a lap to go, absolutely side by side, but Valentino Rossi leads here at Assen. Gibernau fights back, tries to take him round the outside. Rossi pushes him wide. Half a lap to go, they're at the bottom end of the circuit. Rossi has done it, I think.
Rossi looks over his shoulder through the fast right Duikerschnur that brings them back up into the back section of this circuit, through this sweeping section. This is where the Yamaha is so strong. Rossi yesterday in qualifying said it absolutely superb time through these second two sections to take pole position. It was a time that was not matched by anybody. Gibernau couldn't even get close to him. He's not going to get close to him here either. Rossi takes victory in the Dutch TT at Assen. Who's going to take third place?
It's going to be Marco Melandri with Max Biaggi fourth. Marco Melandri, second time on a MotoGP podium. Max Biaggi fourth. Nicky Hayden in fifth place. Colin Edwards in sixth place. Great ride by Hayden. But salute the doctor. Salute Valentino Rossi. He leads the World Championship on a Yamaha. Three successive Grand Prix victories. Rossi the world champion and the new World Championship leader.
Well, this is where he did it. Before Sete Gibernau expected it, Valentino Rossi coming into the left-hander at the Dubult corner that then brought them back into the two rights, kept on the inside, held on the brakes, and this is the view from Gibernau's onboard cameras. You can see they're rubbed together, actually, coming into the Mandevin, and I think, Nick, really that was the key there, because as soon as they came together, Gibernau had to brake, and then he just lost the ground on Rossi. He couldn't pull it back then, coming up through that fat section. It just gave Rossi the initiative that he needed then to just pull away and save himself the worry of a final chicane attack from Gibernau. But what a performance, the second performance of the day for Marco Melandri, again on the MotoGP podium, as he did do at Catalunya 2 weeks ago. He almost didn't ride here this weekend because he had an arm pump operation 10 days ago. It's an absolutely stunning performance from Melandri, and two Yamahas on the podium once again.
Just Nicky Hayden just spoke to his chief mechanic, Trevor Morris. He goes, I never thought I'd say this, but I wish this race was 25 laps long here in Assen. But he says again, for Nicky Hayden, what a race from him. He's gone so far behind at the start. He was 16th place on the grid, 16th place around that first lap. Come up, challenge for the podium position. If Nicky Hayden could have got his qualifying sorted, maybe we'd have seen him up there fighting for the podium. A great race as well from Colin Edwards just alongside him as well. The two Italians though, Marco Melandri and Max Biaggi, just having the upper edge coming through the chicane there into the straight to finish off those podium positions.
Final results: Rossi, Gibernau, Melandri, Biaggi, Hayden, Edwards, Chaus, Caparossi, Checker. Disappointing ninth place for Carlos Checker. He makes such a good start from the front row of the grid. 10th, Neil Hodgson. Good performance by the World Superbike champion. Abe and Tamada, the two Japanese riders, one on a Yamaha, one on a Honda. Hoffman, Hopkins, Jeremy McWilliams, winner of the 250cc race here 3 years ago. A final point. Kenny Roberts in 16th place, Chris Burns 17th. But where does this end? When he switched from Honda to Yamaha, everybody thought it would take a lot longer than the sixth round of the World Championship for him to be leading the title. Gibernau, no great hurry to take off his helmet.
Yeah, I think you're right there, Nick. Just keeping the visor down, keeping his helmet on. I don't think he's very, very happy under that, Sete Gibernau. I think he thinks that's just been nicked off him. He's done all the donkey work throughout the whole race. And then Rossi does it, doesn't it, in his inimitable style on the last lap.
Two great friends, Valentino Rossi and Marco Melandri. And Melandri benefiting so much from Rossi's arrival at Yamaha, perhaps more than any other rider. Certainly it's helped Carlos Checa make some steps forward as well. But Melandri has really benefited from having Rossi there. He's helped him so much, not just setting up the bike, but also his confidence and everything else, and helping him in practice sessions and in testing as well. Gav, before the start of the season, you were down there in Phillip Island when Rossi, you know, was first testing the bike and at the first test in Malaysia. And it seemed to me then that Marco Melandri was already starting to benefit from Rossi's arrival.
Yeah, I mean, at first, I think because Rossi went so quick straight away on the Yamaha, I think it shook Marco Melandri up. I remember speaking to Hervé Poncherolle, team manager for Marco Melandri, at that time in the Sepang and Phillip Island test. I remember him saying to me, I just don't know how Marco's going to react to Valentino because he's going so fast, he's going too fast, he's going faster than anyone ever expected. I think Marco wanted to go that fast, wanted to be able to do that. But in the end, Marco spoke with Valentino Rossi, got some information, just got an idea from Valentino. They shared the information of how the bike should be ridden, what sort of changes were going to be made, and it's helped Marco Melandri, and he's coming out with some superb results. We saw shades of it last season, but he was never quite able to finish it off, probably because of the arm pump problem. Now he's had that operation, he's being able to get in there, get up there, get on the podium twice, and he's fully deserved it.
Well, there you go.
Well, now, was that a clash, do you think, between Valentino Rossi? I think it was, wasn't it?
And yeah, that...
The Valentino Rossi Yamaha and Sete Gibernau's Telefonica movie star Honda on that very last lap. At what bend was that? Because it was the
that was in the Mandavine bend, Nick, coming into the right hander when we saw it from the onboard of Gibernau. No doubt that they touched, and as you can see, the mudguard there on the front wheel of Gibernau broken, and Rossi out of fuel, as we saw there. The marshals having to push him down the pit lane back into Parc Fermé, and Marco Melandri celebrates with his crowd. Another absolutely superb performance. A word for Max Biaggi as well, I think, Nick, to finish as he did in fourth place. An absolutely stunning performance from him as well, considering the difficulties that he had in qualifying as well. And as I say, getting that bike set up, Max Biaggi reckoned that he was losing around 20 kilometres an hour in some of the corners here just because he hasn't had time to set his bike up. And we all know how critical that is for Biaggi to get it set up how he likes. And as I say, losing 20 kilometres an hour in the corners there simply down to set up.
Now, what is the relationship going to be like between Valentino Rossi and Sete Gibernau, and they've both arrived back in Parc Fermé? Usually they shake hands and are really good mates, aren't they?
Yeah,
I have a feeling that Gibernau is not going to be quite so happy this time. Rossi celebrates. And
when Rossi made that manoeuvre and he clipped the front wheel there, I'm sure I saw Sete just sit up, shake his head. He really wasn't happy with the move from Rossi. It was perfectly legal. He was just faster, quicker, later into the corner, just did everything to keep Sete at bay. But yeah, you could see him just sit up and have a shake of his head. I just wonder whether he was cursing underneath that helmet.
Has the visor come up? That's what we want to know.
From Sete.
Has Sete's Gibernau's visor come up yet?
He's got his hat on backwards.
Oh, he's not so bad.
He mustn't be too disappointed, but I'm sure he'll have expected, when he's led that race for so long, I'm sure he'll have expected. He did put in some fantastic laps at the end there. They were within 1,000th of a second, both their times on that penultimate lap. And it was just a case of Sete was pushing. It looked, we said it between us, that we thought he'd done enough. We thought he'd done enough to win the race, but it just turned out that it wasn't quite there at the end.
Well, there was a rather cruel jibe in the Sprocket cartoon this week that we see in MCN in England and also over in Australia, that the way for Rossi to keep Gibernau behind him in the race was to put